लास्ट टाइम एज वी एंडेड अप लिटिल बिट अब्रप्टली एज इट वाज माय सन हु डिडंट अलाउड मी ऑल दिस थिंग्स ओके सो लेट्स बिगिन देन टुडे विथ लिटिल बिट ऑफ क्विक रिवीजन एंड देन वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद द न्यू पोर्शन ऑफ द ब्रेन एंड लेट मी सी हाउ मच वी कैन डू फॉर टुडे ओके सो द थिंग इज as we were doing the portion of the brain and we did that how it is protected in the cover and what are the parts of the that how it is being divided and how that it has so many ingredients I will say inside like if you say that dura mater pia mater is there then gray matter white matter is there so that part we have done and regarding the classification the way your book is being teaching you it is being concentrating on basically on the cerebellum cerebrum and medulla oblongata and we did the cerebrum first because it is the largest part of the brain And we did some very important portion of it. So the thing is, as it is divided into two hemispheres, the cerebrum have two hemispheres, and they are called cerebral hemispheres. And definitely, they have the control on our. That is why our body is having the division of right and left, just because of these hemispheres. But that doesn't mean that if that means both the hemispheres of the brain are correlating the right and left portion of the body with each other, and that is how they function for both the sides. Ultimately, minor things like suppose in cerebral hemisphere, it is not like that only the right part of the cerebral hemisphere will take care of your right part of your body, or left will take care of your only the left part of your body. Definitely, it has some divisions in it, okay? But they correlate the functions of from both the sides, and they work accordingly. But a very severe damage or a very severe physical, chemical, anything, any shock like that, that may cause the paralysis to, I think you may have heard that half of the body is getting paralyzed and all that. Only the right side is working and left side is not working. So that means that's a very serious damage is occurring in the cerebral hemisphere, and that is the reason it leads to the paralysis and all that. Okay. So we studied that how that structure is being designed with these folds and all that, downward, upward fold, and they are related to, I think we have discussed that how they are related to your intelligence and all that. Okay. So see to this that these cerebral hemisphere they both are it is like this they are located like this okay so they have a groove between them the one they have a connection between them these left and right portion and they are just like lobes so they are just situated like this and they have this connection where this junction is responsible for exchanging the information from left to right and right to left. That is what it is doing. And the bridge that is created that is called corpus callosum. Okay. So it will help out in bridging the information between left hemisphere and right hemisphere of the brain. And I think I must have shown you these diagrams on that day. I don't remember basically, actually. I just show you it once again so that it will be clear for you also. Can you see this?
Yes, ma'am.
So these are the hemisphere. You can see a very good division in between. And this is how the hemispheres are separated. If this the thing and left and right hemisphere, you have so many labelings over here, and all these things are because it is all for a higher class, so don't worry regarding that. But basically, definitely, you can relate them wherever it is, whatever is written. Some of the labelings you can relate, and you can identify that how a complex structure can be formed when you just take up the brain and you look at ventrally. Okay, so this is how it will look. And you have some of the glands are also associated over at this place. These glands are the parts of endocrine system. These glands are not the part of the brain, just remember that. Okay, so they are the part of endocrine system, but as they are associated structurally very much, that means present in the brain only, that is why they are labeled with this labelings over here. And some labelings like pons, infundibulum and all that, but pons you will pons is a very important labeling. I think in your book it is also mentioned. This pons are the bridges, bridge between medulla oblongata and cerebellum, and cerebrum and cerebellum also. So it's a common bridge between the whole brain. And I think I must have informed you that as brain has a division like forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. This is another way you can classify the brain. Okay, so basically it helps out when you are sectioning the brain, when you have to understand the brain by sectioning it, and this is how you can look to the sections. Okay, because inside you have to see what is there. So at that time you have to come across with these types of things like pons and all that, so you will understand them better. Okay, so this is how it connects cerebral in between blue region you can see. Okay, so, see here it is being labeled as pons. But the pon is the one, it is connecting the everything. That means cerebrum and cerebellum also, and cerebrum and medulla oblongata also. So pons is a major bridge which is connecting all these parts of the brain. Okay, so this is how you have to understand this thing. Okay, now as we were doing this part, I think, is there any doubt in cerebrum there?
No, ma'am.
Okay. It is easy. In your book, actually, it is given in detail. So many things are given according to the diagram. But in explanation in your book, it is being not followed. Okay. And another thing, if the problem is they are providing you some information, but in between they are lost. Means the way it should be completed, that is not there. So I feel that after reading your book and all that, that is my review. But the thing is, because according to the diagram, I think one diagram is there, one black and white diagram is there in your textbook. And it is having so many labelings in it on the top of the page. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am. Totally full.
Yes, it is having so many labelings, but nothing is there in the explanation. So I don't know if your school is following all of them or not. But I will be trying to cover some of them. so that you should be aware of at least the names from where it is coming. Okay, so that is why, because in detail if you go, it will take too much of time. So that is why it is not being, I'm not concentrating much for the explanation. Okay. So let's see for the cerebellum. And I think I must, I'm not drawing the diagram. A basic thing, if you draw the diagram for the brain, then you should understand that. This is how you can see inner structure. Something like this can be seen when you draw. And this is how it can be seen. And after that, you have a division like this. This is how it is there. And somewhere here, it will be coming up. It's just a basic diagram. Technically, this is not the correct thing, but just to mention these three parts which are explained in your book, that is why I am doing that. This is how it should be. It should be there. And so basically, only the three portions which have been explained according to your book. So the one which is this type of structure, branch tree like, that is called cerebellum. And here with the grooves and all that, that is called cerebrum. Okay. And you can see that corpus callosum is there. Then you have these grooves like over here. So here it will be the medulla oblongata, something like that will be present. And here you can see something is hanging out, that is pituitary gland, and hypothalamus will be the region over here. And this is how the labelings will come up. But the thing is, these three things are being explained in your book. So this is how you should concentrate when you go for the diagram. Okay, so let's see about for the cerebellum. It's a very important part, and definitely it is called a small brain of your body, and it controls almost all of the involuntary actions in your body, and it has so many. Just hold on.
Ma'am, you are on mute.
Okay, now it's okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So basically, the way the cerebral hemispheres have grooves and convolutions and all that, it is this part doesn't have that. It has just like the furrows. Furrows means it has a lining. You can see the clear lining, which makes it makes the appearance like a branch tree, and it doesn't have grooves or gyri and sulci. That part is not there. Okay. And here also that outer cortex, outer side is made up of gray matter, and inner it is completely, this branching is completely white in nature. So this outer region will be having the gray section over here, and while inner one will be the white matter. So this is how you should be aware of. And this is a very important part, and it makes you able to stand, to walk, to maintain the body balance. Okay, so it is very important for maintaining your body balance, for coordinations and all that. Coordinations, I will just explain you one simple activity, then you will be understanding it. And then your muscular actions and all that all are responsible for the responsible, and they are working from the cerebellum center only. Okay, now body balance and coordination, what does that mean? I think you must have learned a little bit about the structure of ear, that is the inner ear. Have you studied it?
No, ma'am.
Okay, fine, not. Okay, so we will be coming up, I think sense organs and something like that will be coming up. You will understand that. Okay, but just understand that this body balance and coordination is related to our ear also. So our ear has a direct connection over here. Okay, and how it is that, why it is so, that you will understand when you will study the structure of ear. Just see that you may have experienced that if you are walking on a very thin track, suppose the railway track, you are, when you are playing on it, or, and you try to balance your body by walking over it. So you will keep your feet just very slowly and very cautiously you will be moving over it. Am I right? If not railway tracks, then you must have been walking on the parapet of your terrace or something like that, on the boundaries of the terrace or your balcony. Sometimes you must have climbed it and tried to balance your body, or you must have seen the people who are doing the circus, they walk on the rope. Have you seen it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so if you have not experienced it, then you must have seen that somebody who is walking on a very thin track, if you don't have a space to walk around and you just have a thin line where you have to maintain your body balance, then suddenly your hands will come up in the air and they will be just spreaded widely on side by side, and they will try to maintain the body balance. Have you experienced it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that is a sudden reaction. Nobody has taught you that you have to do like that. But your hands will automatically will be in the air and on the side by side, and you will be trying to maintain your body according to your hands. So that activity is controlled by your cerebellum, and that is very important. That means if you are walking nicely and you don't have to worry about the balance of your body, it is, the whole credit goes to the cerebellum. The kids who just learn to walk, they don't have developed the cerebellum. Their cerebellum is still for having that formation and all that. So that is why they cannot walk properly. Okay. So they just fall down. They don't have the ability to maintain the body balance. Another thing, you must have seen the people who drink heavily. They have the... They develop that they cannot walk properly, and they just move here and there, and they cannot walk the straight path. The reason is the alcohol affects the cerebellum much, and that's why they lose the body balance and the coordination. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is the reason. The cerebellum is affected directly by the alcohol. And in kids, it is still developing, so it is trying to maintain that part. And that's why kids are, when kids just start, when they develop the sense of the balance and all that, then their cerebellum will be also developing accordingly. You may have seen that when kids are walking, when the small toddler is walking, they will just put their hands up in the air to maintain the body balance. Have you seen it?
No, ma'am. Not quite often.
Not seen. Just watch the television in the ads. You can see in the babies' ads when the babies are walking. You can see that they will just lift their hands up in the air, or they will try to maintain. So that sense of learning is coming from there only. Nobody is teaching them that you have to lift your hand up for your body balance or that. Okay, so this you can see on the television also. So many ads are there when the babies are walking. Okay, so the thing is all depends on the cerebellum and all the coordination. That means the way when your legs are moving, your hands will be moving side by side, your body on its own. Nobody does or you don't do it purposefully by moving your hands. So that type of movement coordination comes up with the help of cerebellum. Then other coordination, like when you are playing something like cricket and all that, so you have to you know that you have to jump, you have to catch a ball, at the same time you have to come down on the feet, you have to throw the ball. That all coordination is maintained by the cerebellum. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so it includes all the muscular activities, and so that is why this cerebellum is responsible for it. So that much is given, and I think that much is enough for this cerebellum portion. Then you have this medulla oblongata. Medulla oblongata. It is considered as the most inferior part of the brain. Inferior means it is located at the base of your at the lowest region of the brain. It is located, and it is having a pyramid shape. Shape is just the way, if you observe it, if you take out it separately, then you will observe that it has a shape of a pyramid, and not that much conical or something like that, but definitely it will give you some view like that. And posterior most, the inferior most, if you can say, and it connects connects the brain and spinal cord. So very important part of your brain, definitely. And one thing regarding cerebellum, I will say that you must have, because in Indian movies, something about scientific type of thing doesn't come up. It is very rare. And I think there is one movie of Salman Khan and Kareena Kapoor, and I think the name is Kyun Ki. Okay, and in that, at the end, the man is the hero is lying on the bed, and some discussion is shown in between the doctors. If you hear that properly, they will term this thing that they have removed, that is why the patient is lying like that. A little bit of information is there. You can hear that discussion if you want to. Okay, so
yes, ma'am.
The person can see the things, they can understand the things, they can do everything, but the muscular activity is being restricted. Okay, so this is Indian movies, rarely something intelligent something comes up. Definitely Hollywood is also not showing very intelligent things, but this is how you can relate the things easily. Okay, so let's see for medulla oblongata. So it is a connection between brain and the spinal cord, and this region of the brain, if it is getting damaged, then it can lead to the death of the person. That much important it is, okay, because it have the center for everything. I will say your heart, your kidney, your digestion, respiration, everything, even the flow of the blood and all that, they all are depending on medulla oblongata. So your cardiac activities, if I say, cardiac means heart activities, and your respiration, and then your heartbeat, then the way you have the salivary actions, that means salivation, vomiting, what you will say, take n number of things, sneezing, then you, when you eat the food, the food should move down automatically in it towards your stomach, so that is done by peristalsis, that you may be aware of. So the thing, all these things are controlled by medulla oblongata, and a little bit of damage can lead to the even the paralysis and sudden death also. That much sensitive this region is. And the medulla oblongata, as it is making the connection between brain and spinal cord, so if sometimes the damage can, you can see that the lower part of the body is getting paralyzed and all that. So at that time, medulla oblongata is performing so many functions which are being restricted, and but the blood flow and all that is being followed by medulla oblongata. That's why the body part which is not, which is being paralyzed, it should not get starting to the deterioration and all that. So credit goes to the medulla oblongata for managing all the things. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Because once the paralysis occurs to the body, that means that much part of the body is not able to sensitize the things. Okay. And but that means it is almost dead. It is not giving you any type of sensation. It is not giving you any type of reflexes or any type of response. So the thing is, that body part should not get means it should not start deteriorating. Means like just the way dead body is deteriorates, it should not be the case. So blood flow and other things should be continued, and that is taken care by medulla oblongata and all that. This is how it keeps the body alive. So that is why it is very important part. And this is how it, major portion of the brains are being covered over here. And anything to be asked from your side, just let me know that.
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, okay. So I think you may have, when you will read the cerebral hemisphere, then you will see that you have that division also, subconscious mind, conscious mind, the way you dream the things. All these questions may arise at your part, possibly, because subconscious and conscious, how they are working. And see, I will say that the way you have studied cerebral hemisphere, cerebellum, medulla oblongata and other parts, subconscious and conscious is nothing, something physically it is not there. It is just the division that this much part of the brain is maintaining the subconscious things, and this much part of the brain is maintaining the conscious activities. So when you are awake, the brain is something different. When you are sleeping, the brain activities are something different. It is continuously working. That is very important part of the brain. Okay. So the way you dream, and sometimes you may feel that something is happening to you really, So all these pictures come out of your brain only, nothing else is there. And even if you have that fears of some, like the way you feel that in the dark, sometimes you somebody is standing there, you have a sensation that somebody is there, that all everything is nothing but the your brain is developing some type of pictures. And that is why that subconscious mind is suddenly becomes very active in nature. Is it clear to you? Got it, Ayush?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, the thing is, what your 90% of fears are the pictures developed by your brain only. So the because you see so many things, movies, horror movies, you hear so many stories, and everything is being captured by your brain, and that is how the brain functions. Whatever it has experienced, it will give you the same type of feeling. Okay, so that much how powerful the brain can be. So let's see that if we go to the other part, that is somatic nervous system and autonomic nervous system, that is also a very important, and the thing, it is very beautifully doing its work. Okay, so we will doing the peripheral nervous system after this. And that is, we will, let's see about the somatic nervous system over here. So peripheral is nothing but as it is being spreaded, and it is the whole, it is responsible for sensitizing the things and all that. So somatic nervous system, I will write the short form over here. Somatic nervous system is responsible for the production of nerves and all that. And so first it will give you the cranial nerves. Cranial nerves, they are arising from the brain, and because cranium is the box in which brain is situated, that is why they are termed as cranial nerves, and they are 12 pairs in numbers. And definitely 12 pairs are there because you have left and right part of your body. That is why these nerves are in pairs. Okay. So you have sensory coming out of it. You have auditory coming out of it. Olfactory and auditory, all these. Olfactory. So sensory have two things, auditory, olfactory will be coming out. Auditory means the things through which you can hear. Olfactory means you can smell, your nose and all that. Okay. Then you have motor nerves from coming out of your these cranial nerves, and they are nothing but like eyes and all that will be included over here. Then you have some of the mixed one. The one which is mixed, and that is coming from your tongue and your face and all that. So these are the reasons these 12 pairs are being divided. They are also having numbers, but you don't have to worry, as your in book is, it is not there. So just understand that this is how the face is being having a network of nerves. Your whole upper body part is being divided like this. Then you have the spinal nerves. The nerves coming out of your spinal cord, and it have 31 pairs. And I think you may have studied in class 9th your skeletal system. Am I right? Are you aware of the skeletal system?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So
yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We have studied.
So all the words are almost similar. You can relate them very much. Okay. So eight pairs will be coming out from your neck region. Then you have 12 pairs coming out of thorax. Then you have 5 pairs coming out of your lumbar region and 5 from the sacral and 1 from the coccygeal. I think you are aware of these words. Do I have to, you know the where they are situated, am I right?
Yes, ma'am. These are of vertebral system.
Vertebral column. It has this type of division. And these are the number of vertebral rings. This is how the rings you can count on them. So from each ring, these types of nerves are coming up. So it is nothing but I will show you the way you have wear your wristwatch. It is similar structure, something like that. So wristwatch is having something like this, that this type of division is there. So the way you have your wristwatch, the way you wear it, so it has two divisions. Similarly, vertebral ring is also having it. So from the center, the nerves are arising on both the side, and that's why they should be in pairs, because for both the sides they are developing, and that is also they are developing, and they are responsible for the reaching to till the end of your body organs, and from there they will be taking up the responses and it will be coming up to the spinal cord. Okay, so spinal cord is nothing but a very thin and very soft, delicate structure which is passing through this vertebral column. Just the way you have a lid in your pen. So if this is the vertebral column, inside the one which you can remove, let me see if I have it. So this is how it can be seen, that if this outer structure is a vertebral column, so inner side, this is how the spinal cord is being there. And this spinal cord divides at every junction to give rise to the spinal nerves. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, this is how these nerves are present. And the thing is, your spinal cord is almost itself, it is very smart in maintaining so many things. So when you will see that autonomic nervous system along with this, because somatic nervous system will give rise to nerves, and autonomic nervous system will be divided as a parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system, because chains of nerves and whatever is dividing, they will give rise to parasympathetic and sympathetic part. So let me see if I write down that autonomic nervous system. There is a diagram in your textbook in which the whole spine is given, and in that divisions are there, that from this region, this is controlled from thorax and all that. I think it is there in the lower part of your book somewhere. You can see that. Is it there?
Yes, ma'am. Autonomous nervous system.
Autonomous nervous system. So this is giving rise to nerves, and then the control comes from the autonomic nervous system, because all these chains of nerves, and they form the ganglia. Ganglia is nothing but the group of the nerves when they are combined and they are responsible for so many work. So they will form a ganglia. A gang-like structure, that's why it is called ganglia. And this autonomic nervous system is responsible for almost major involuntary actions of your body. Because now see this, as it is situated in your spine region, because everything cannot be loaded to the brain. Everything should not go up till the brain because brain itself has so many things to do. It has to maintain the memory, it has to maintain other parts also, maintain the functions of inner body parts also. So there are some time that you require a sudden decisions and all that, sudden activities has to be done, and that is taken care by this autonomic nervous system basically. That means this whole peripheral nervous system. So how it is working when you talk about sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system? Okay. So basically, this sympathetic nervous system, nerves are arising from spinal cord, and they are spreaded between your neck, from neck to waist region. Almost all the sympathetic part is situated over there, and while parasympathetic is having a division, one in head and another one in another in neck. Okay. And then after the sacral part of your body, posteriorly, it should be there. Sacral part. Okay. So this is how it should be divided. Now see this, actually this sympathetic and parasympathetic are meant to balance each other. Okay. So they are responsible that the thing should not be crossing the maximum limit, that and the thing should not be going down to the minimum limit. That is maintained by sympathetic and parasympathetic. First, one example is that your heartbeat, I think it is around 70 to 72 beats per minute. It is there like this. Okay, sometimes 75 range must be there. But 70 to 72 per minute beats should be there when your heart is beating. So it should not cross that limit. Plus minus 5 or 10 is okay. But it should not cross the maximum and the minimum range. Otherwise, it can lead to the danger in your body. Okay, so that balance is done by sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. And the sympathetic one is the thing which is almost disturbing the balance of your body. That means crossing the limit comes under sympathetic, and maintaining the limit comes under the parasympathetic. That is how they are doing their function. But why this one is crossing the limit? It has its own reason. Reason is that this part of nervous system, it has its trigger in the gland called adrenal gland. Okay, adrenal gland is located on kidney. The way your kidney is there, on the top of it, cone-like structure is there. So that is an adrenal gland. Okay, so this adrenal gland is responsible for one hormone that is called adrenaline. Okay, it is responsible for production of adrenaline, and this adrenaline is so effective hormone that it can cause so many things suddenly in your body. Okay, so I think you must have heard about adrenal rush. Have you heard it?
Yes, ma'am. It gives us energy.
Yes, it gives you the energy. It gives you the power. It gives you like you are the king of the world. That is the feeling will come if the adrenaline rushes more. So it has its trigger over here. That's why this sympathetic nervous system is responsible for crossing the limits. I will just give you one example over here. That suppose if you are the person who is continuously being treated the way like very negative treatment comes from one of the teacher, if suddenly a very negative type of comment or negative type of feedback comes to you, like you are nothing, you can't do anything, you are the waste, you are this, you are that, then you will feel the anger. you can see that you can and you will control yourself that because of the teacher you will not try to answer suddenly, but at some point you will lose your control and you will start talking that don't talk to me like that. Okay, so that type of thing will come when the adrenaline is being released in your body. Because of these types of things, the adrenaline will be released and suddenly the person, I'm not talking to you particularly, but the thing is, this is how it happens, that the person will suddenly stand up and it will raise its voice that you don't have the authority to talk to me like that. Then you can see the face is turning red. The person may be shaking also in anger, and there may be the possibility it will start sweating. The tears may fall out of the eyes, or anger is so much that the face become red, flush red is there. So all these things is called adrenaline rush. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so anger is definitely one thing where you can see this adrenaline rush. Then another thing, you can see the sports person who are playing the particular sport. And suppose if they achieve the thing on the ground, like in the football, the footballer, when they do the goal after in a very difficult condition, and after some they just obtained, they reached that particular achievement after struggling for so much of time, then you can see their reaction. They will just, you can see that their neck region or the neck region will become tight, their nerves can be seen very clearly, and they will show you like you can see the fist like this, and they will bang their head also. So that is also adrenaline rush. And see, that person is playing, okay? So definitely they do have this adrenaline rush. But you can see that reaction in the public or the audience who is sitting and watching that particular game. They are not playing actually. But if they are the supporters, you can see that they are also going mad over it, and they will also show you some very energetic type of activity from their body. Have you seen it? Have you seen it?
Yes, ma'am.
Have you seen that thing that even the spectators who are watching the game, they will show you some very instant or very spontaneous reactions that
yes ma'am
if they are supporting that particular team?
Ma'am, not seen, but felt also
fine.
Yes, if you are playing a football match, ma'am.
Yes, playing a football, and nowadays I think most of the population is going mad over IPL. There also you can see that.
Yes.
Okay, so this is how this adrenaline rush comes to you. Now, another example, if you can see, let me take up that. Suppose if right now we have the classroom and I'm teaching in front of you, okay, and there is a class going on for 10 to 15 students, suppose all of them were studying, and after the class is over, every student will move out. Okay, by leaving the classroom. And if I am standing, I am the one who is the last, as a teacher, I am standing inside and doing my work inside the classroom. And suddenly one of the student is, let me take example of yours only. Suddenly you have a doubt and you want to ask me something. And you come in the classroom, and if you see me in the pool of blood, what will be your reaction? You will be shocked?
Yes, ma'am.
You will be shocked. You will be, definitely your heartbeat will go shoot up.
No,
like
ma'am. I will No, ma'am. I will think that you are a biology teacher, so you may have performed practicals.
Okay, so that's a good thing. But the
But ma'am, if
sudden
I does it, if I do not know who you are, then it will.
yeah, then the thing is, if you see such awkward situation, then definitely the first reaction will whoosh, what happened, like question mark thing, like will come in your mind first of all, and you will feel little bit scary. You will feel that face will turn suddenly white or something due to fear and all that. And definitely, if the person you are not knowing, then you will try to run up from that situation. So that fear-like thing is also developed by the sympathetic nervous system. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So all these things like fear, anger, then when you are very much depressed, the person who is crying a lot, so they are also having these types of reactions. And I think all these sexual stimulation will also be controlled by sympathetic nervous system, that if when the person is adult, and if the person is sexually stimulated by the watching out the thing, or if it feels the sexual stimulus, it is all controlled by sympathetic nervous system. Because when sexual stimulation occurs, at that time also heartbeat increases and all that, all these things occurs. So that is all controlled by sympathetic nervous system. And opposite actions are taken by parasympathetic. That means they will try to control all these which are going out of the range. They will try to control the things. That is parasympathetic. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so basically all your emotions, any type of emotions, will be over here. And see, sudden continuous fear, continuous anger, continuous sadness, continuous negative thoughts, all may lead to the diseases also in a body. Okay, so it may lead to some type of disease that definitely that depression and all that will be there. But the thing is, physical diseases also may develop, like the person may suffer from blood pressure, they due to anxiety and all that. They may have the obesity, that means I think some of the people who are very much depressed, they try to eat a lot, so they will become heavy and they become obese. So all these diseases will also be capturing these types of individuals. Understood this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is how this whole nervous system will be working. So till here, I think it's okay. And do you have the school right now?
Yes, ma'am, from 8, 8, 5.
From 8:05. Okay, fine. So here it is. Next time we'll be doing some involuntary actions and all that, and how these reflex arcs are being formed, and conditioned reflexes and all that. Then it will finish the chapter. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So bye. Have a good day.
Yes, ma'am. Same to you. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, welcome.